Welcome to our session on global enforcement trends. I'm Dorothy Cory-Wright, and I'm a partner in the London office where I head the disputes and contentious regulatory practice. And I have two of my partners from London with me today, Matthew Banham and John Bedford. We also have Maria Sitt, who heads Deckert's Asian white collar practice and is a partner in our Hong Kong office. And we have Anthony Kelly, who's a partner from our Washington office, who's a former co-chief of the SEC's Enforcement Division's Asset Management Unit. We're looking at enforcement trends today, and there's been so much debate about what route global agencies are going to take. Will they step up their enforcement? Will they be concerned about the state of the economy post-pandemic? And will that take them will that cause them to take their foot off the brake a bit? All being hotly debated at the moment. Of course, 2020 was an unprecedented year, that adjective again, but so many things happened which have been relevant to asset managers, clearly the pandemic. People working from home, so harder to control, arguably, working patterns, people's knowledge, than when people are situated and working in an office. The rise of cryptocurrency, we've all been reading in the press from day to day, quite what's happening there, how is that going to be regulated, how can enforcement activity take place. In Europe, we've had the effects of Brexit and finally the exit of the United Kingdom from the EU, with the trade and cooperation agreement in place, but no clear guidelines and exception at the moment for financial services. Of course, the change of administration in the US, which has generated a great deal of discussion, and recent issues, for example, the GameStop share trading, which have highlighted the tensions, the difficulties of trying to regulate and carry out enforcement against both professional and retail investors. So with that preamble, I'm going to turn it over to our very informed panel just to give us a few of their views. I'm going to start with Matt. Matt, the FCA fired a warning shot last year in its Dear CEO letter, observing there was significant scope for improvement, in particular in relation to market abuse controls in the alternative investment firm space. What sort of changes have you seen people undertake, or do you recommend they need to undertake, particularly in view of the new mixed working, i.e. from home and the office?
Thanks, Dorothy. So you're right, they did fire that warning shot, and that was before we really got into the whole heat of the pandemic. And I think it's important we separate the enhanced controls firms need to have been putting in place as a result of the at-home working and the specific issues that have arisen from that type of focus and the work that's having to carry on away from the controlled office environment. And just pause and go back to what was happening before that happened. The FCA were unhappy with what they saw when they did their site visits on various firms. They felt, I think, specifically in the alternative fund management space, that there were lax controls. There wasn't sufficient rigor around policies and procedures to ensure that they were bespoke, by which the FCA want to see firms tailoring policies and procedures to the risks of that particular business model that they have. And not just have those policies on a desk or on a shelf, but to ensure that they work. And that's where they were falling down. They were saying the right things, but putting it into practice and evidencing that it worked just wasn't happening. And so that's the backdrop from what we now have, which has been exacerbated because of COVID-19. As we know, the pandemic's wreaked havoc on both individuals and businesses. And that's brought about a whole new set of risks that the FCA is keen to manage and for firms to avoid, which I'm sure you're alive to as well. Particular issues have arisen around the volume of inside information that's circulating in the markets at the moment. There's issues around the firm's financial health. There's increased activity in the capital markets section. And as you highlighted, Dorothy, you know, the risks posed by remote working, the use of private and unmonitored devices and phones is a real concern for the FCA. And they've taken action before against individuals and firms for misconduct involving the use of WhatsApp and other social media platforms. So the FCA really expects the firms and, importantly, senior management have a rigorous monitoring regime that's in place for in-scope activities that may be conducted away from the controlled office environment.
So Matt, having outlined that, of course, many executives within asset managers are particularly concerned about fulfilling their obligation under the senior managers regime, SMCR. And can you give us some examples of what people should be doing to ensure their systems and controls and oversight are proper and sufficient?
Yes, of course. So I think the most sensible thing firms should be doing straight away is to make sure that their market abuse policies and procedures remain fit and proper. So what that requires is that there should be a review done very quickly, if it hasn't been done already, to ensure, for example, insider lists remain up to date and are being effective in monitoring who has access to material and at what stages. That should happen on a frequent policy, on a frequent basis, and set out in policy. Firms should also revisit their current policies that they've had in place to ensure that it accommodates working from home practices. So, for example, we are all now familiar with this virtual environment of working on Teams and Zoom. The FCA will expect senior managers to check whether these channels are being used properly by staff. And if they can't put in place sufficient controls around that, then those facilities should either be banned or they should be used and they should be recording for all execution and transmission that relate to in-scope activity. So firms really need to ensure that they have the right compliance tools. And that's what senior managers need to do. Do they have the right tools for the job? Do they understand what those tools will do? And do they understand how best to implement new changes? And do they have the staff and the confidence in their staff to ensure that they meet the risks as they move forward in this ever-changing environment?
So Matt, you've helped me focused on what asset managers can do best to avoid enforcement activity. But if you're doing a bit of crystal ball gazing, what do you think the enforcement trends will be in relation to market abuse in the coming year, 2 years?
Thanks, Dorothy. So I think when the pandemic subsides a little, I think the FCA will very much be pouring through all of the huge amounts of data that it has that comes to it. A lot of that data comes from suspicious activity reports. And I think we will find that there are examples of incidents where employees have misused client confidential information for their own purposes and set up insider dealing. There is obviously concerns around front running as well. And these breaches of also of inside information that may come out in relation to the delaying of disclosure obligations by firms is something that the FCA will be very acute about and will be very sharp if firms have failed to do that and comply and update their rules and procedures quickly enough. And also for those firms who have lent out equities around dividend dates, they may well find themselves caught up in what's becoming the world's largest tax investigation, that relating to Cum-Ex. We still have the FCA determining what, if any, regulatory action it should take. But the mood music is very much clear that they are looking to take action and they are looking to move that investigation forward. So I do remind firms as well that they have that obligation to report suspicions and concerns of potential market abuse. They should do that through the store regime. And FCA will be checking, I am sure, in the months to come, whether there have been sufficient and continuous reports of suspicious activity at the levels that they would expect. And if they don't, then they will come and ask questions.
Thanks, Matt. John, Matt's been talking about the market abuse regime. From your recent experience and using your crystal ball again, I mean, what do you think the other enforcement trends of relevance to asset managers will be in the coming year or years?
Thank you, Dorothy. I think FCA enforcement is likely to continue taking action where there have been significant gaps and weaknesses in firm systems and controls. Whilst this isn't a new area for enforcement activity, the current climate presents challenges for a firm systems and controls that could highlight or exacerbate existing weaknesses. Matthew has touched on some of those in the context of homeworking and market abuse risks. It's worth remembering that the FCA rules give the regulator pretty broad scope to take action against firms for deficiencies in their systems and controls. For example, in relation to specific breaches in the CIS section of the FCA handbook, but also the FCA has historically relied as well on the principle 3 to take enforcement action in relation to having adequate risk management systems in place. Importantly for the asset management sector, the FCA's Dear CEO letter last January highlighted some areas of particular focus for the FCA. The letter noted that progress was needed and that governance levels had fallen below expectations and there'd been inadequate investment in some areas that had led to deficient systems. The letter demonstrates that systems and controls within asset managers to monitor and manage conflicts of interest continue to be an area of focus for the FCA. We've certainly seen that in our work for our asset management clients. Usually it's an area that you can, you know, it's an issue that can be handled with interactions with the supervision division rather than it being escalated to an enforcement case. But the FCA will take action in egregious cases where a firm has, you know, had repeated conflicts of interest issues or, you know, and it's particularly egregious. Another point arising from the letter is that the FCA will be monitoring how firms address cyber and data security risks. This has obviously taken on increasing importance since the letter was published, given people have moved to remote working and the various challenges that poses, in addition to the market abuse risk that Matt highlighted. In addition, there have been stories in the press about data breaches, and there have also been some pretty significant hacking incidents, most importantly and recently the SolarWinds hack. Whilst asset managers might not consider that this is a risk that, you know, it's a key issue that directly impacts on them, it's clear that the FCA considers it should be. And in any event, it is also clear that the data held by asset managers is pretty valuable, and that inevitably means that, you know, hackers and other cyber criminals will be looking for weaknesses. The Dear CEO letter also touched on liquidity management issues and highlighted the FCA's ongoing work in this area. The letter noted that ensuring effective liquidity management is a central responsibility for any A firm, even if they delegate investment management activities to others. This has obviously been a key focus area for the FCA since the issues with the Woodford Fund in 2019, and the FCA is somewhat under the microscope in this area, so it's likely to want to seem to be take action in this area. Moving away from the points identified in that Dear CEO letter, the also found AML and sanctions issues to be pretty fruitful areas for enforcement action in the past, and that's likely to continue. On the AML side of things, the pandemic, you know, obviously poses additional challenges in conducting appropriate, you know your customer checks and monitoring your systems and controls to make sure they're able to withstand the challenges that the pandemic has posed. On the sanction side of things, and this moves slightly into the Brexit area, the UK's departure from the EU means that the UK has its own standalone sanctions regimes. Whilst the broad targets of those regimes are largely the same as the EU, there are some important differences in the detail that require greater scrutiny, particularly for those asset managers that invest in Russia, where there are some key divergences between the wording of the EU's sanctions and the UK sanctions. So in summary, Dorothy, I think the FCA will continue to take action in areas where it previously has done so, but obviously the current conditions mean that there's increasing pressure on a firm's systems and controls, and that any weaknesses are likely to be highlighted or exacerbated in the current climate.
Thanks, John. And I think you make the point on the cyber and data security risk very well, because almost every matter I've been involved in recently seems to have had either a hack or some data security issue crop up. It is an increasing area of concern. Just before I turn to Asia and our view from Maria, Matt, one last question. We talked about the senior managers regime and the sort of things we think that senior managers need to do to protect their position. But what do you think the enforcement appetite is going to be for asset managers, particularly when they're relatively new entrants into this regime?
So I don't think there will be an immediate enforcement appetite for that very reason. In fact, if we go back to the banks who've had to live with this regime for the longest period of time, there's certainly no published enforcement action against any senior managers to date. But what there will be is increased scrutiny, certainly at the supervisory level, where the FCA will be asking appropriate questions. So I would expect them to be sending in regulatory requests during the course of this year and into next, asking firms to explain what are senior managers doing to embed this culture now into the firm. Is there sufficient challenge happening within the management body on decisions being taken? What are they doing to evidence that? And is management information clear, and does it add value? So there will be those questions asked, and firms will be expected to respond to it. Those who haven't been able to get up speed quickly enough, yes, there will be areas for leniency, but then there will come a time that it will move to supervision and matters will move on and patience will wear thin. But I think for the time being, it's very much an attitude of working together and to collaborate, but to provide challenge at the right stage to ensure the best outcomes for customers and investors for asset managers.
Thanks very much, Matt and John. Maria, turning to the Hong Kong situation, what's your view on enforcement trends in Hong Kong at the moment and what the future holds?
Sure, thanks, Dorothy. While COVID might have affected businesses globally, it did not seem to have much impact on the regulators in Asia. Targeting funds and asset managers, the SFC had taken 65 enforcement actions over the past 12 months, and not to mention ongoing investigations which have yet to come to fruition. For asset managers and funds, although we have not seen a single fine in billions of dollars, we are seeing repeated heavy fines in the range of 4 to 8 million for very basic internal control deficiencies. In the course of those enforcement actions and ongoing investigations, we have noticed two enforcement trends in Asia. The number one trend is that the internal control deficiencies still remain a key area of concern. In a recent enforcement case concerning the recommendation of bonds, the SFC found that the asset management firm did not have any product approval and due diligence procedures in place for the products in general. While this firm had written policies which require its staff to ensure that the products they recommended to the clients were suitable, in practice, they actually left it to the individual consultants to determine the risks of any particular bond and whether recommendation was reasonably suitable. During the course of the investigation, the SFC also found that there was no framework at all to indicate how different information available, say from third-party platform, the offering circular and other sources ought to have been taken into account to enable the consultant to assess whether the product was suitable for any particular client. The SFC ultimately fined this firm $6.4 million. When one considers that there was no evidence of any complaints by investors or losses suffered by investors, and that the firm had an otherwise clean disciplinary record, a $6.4 million fine may seem high. In another enforcement action, we have witnessed fund managers placing cash deposits of the funds managed by them in instant access cash accounts, what we call the IAC accounts, of other associated entities or affiliates of this fund manager, which fall within the definition of connected persons in Hong Kong. These fund managers did not have any procedures in place to compare the IAC account's interest rates against the interest rates offered by other banks to ensure that the cash deposited with the connected persons receive interest at a rate not lower than the prevailing commercial rate. This may create a potential conflict problem. An independent review also found that while the fund managers had established process to manage cash on a day-to-day requirement basis, the extent of the control was limited as it was not performed on all of the funds. The daily monitoring control on cash balance was also not documented in any policies and procedures. So these two cases demonstrate that the inadequacy and deficiencies of internal controls largely remain a primary concern of the SFC. In particular, fund managers should pay attention to product approval and due diligence procedures, suitability assessments, supervisory system and controls that minimize and manage conflicts of interest. This may all sound very basic, but there are many pitfalls in implementing effective measures in practice, given the way that fund managers operate globally. Another trend that we've identified is non-compliance with overseas regulations, which could also lead to disciplinary action in Hong Kong. The SFC could and had taken disciplinary action in Hong Kong for non-compliance with overseas regulations, even if a majority of the business were conducted overseas. In one of the recent enforcement cases, while the firm was licensed to carry on regulated activities in Hong Kong, the transactions with Taiwan-based clients accounted for 90%+ of distribution of the investment products. The firm's licensed representatives acted as salespersons and were responsible for the distribution of the investment products to the clients in Taiwan. These representatives lived in Taiwan and visited Hong Kong only a couple of days per month. The salesperson, when they were faced with investigation by the SFC, claimed that they understood sales of investment products in Taiwan were not allowed, but they were merely providing clients with general product information and were in Taiwan for a client relationship management perspective. However, the SFC did not take on board their explanation, as the investigation showed that not only did the licensed representatives distribute the investment products and provide investment advice to clients while they were in Taiwan, they also did so with apparently little supervision. The SFC also noted that this firm did not have any procedures to ensure that its business activities were in compliance with the local laws and regulations in Taiwan. Their guidance on cross-border activities were not put in place until much later, and the guidelines did not provide for a step to comply with local laws and regulations. The SFC ultimately fined this firm approximately $2 million for issue on fit and properness. So the key takeaway to asset managers, I think, in Asia who sell their products or provide their investment advice to overseas investors should be aware of the laws and regulations of both Hong Kong and other jurisdictions in which they conduct their business activities, be it US, UK, and in this case, Taiwan. They should also be alive to the possibility that any breaches overseas may have potential ramification in Hong Kong if they are also licensed here. Asset managers with international operations should strive to ensure continuous compliance with the local laws and regulations at where their business operate. I think that is something that from asset managers with global operations should really focus in the next 12 months.
Maria, thank you. That's extremely interesting. Another thing you've mentioned that I picked up on is there seems to be a considerable onus on asset managers to review any new product or different product very carefully and assess the risk it presents. Comparing with the FCA, of course, that's an obligation as well, but the FCA does a lot of centralised work of reviewing product types and how they're being developed in the market. Do you think in Asia there's a greater emphasis on asset managers to review their own product rather, or the product they're considering marketing, rather than having central guidance from the regulator on it?
Yes, in Asia, the FSC plays a lot of burden on the asset managers to do their own work. So I think there is divergence on the way that things are developed in the UK and in Hong Kong in this respect.
Yeah, and we quite often advise our asset manager clients that at least to be able to show you've considered the risk, you know, you hope you get your risk assessment right, but that's not always so easy on new products, but at least to be able to demonstrate consideration at an appropriate level before going forward, it is key to ensuring that if and when there is an enforcement attempt, you have a good response to it to show that you took necessary steps. I assume you'd agree it's the same in Hong Kong.
Exactly, and proper documentation too. You need to demonstrate to the SFC that you have taken these steps and not very lightly. And most times, having proper documentation to evidence the steps that you've taken is very important when the SFC comes knock on the door.
Yeah. Thank you, Maria. Very interesting. And with that, we're going to move across to Anthony Kelly. Anthony, we noticed there's been quite a few changes going on in your jurisdiction of late, and that's led to much commentary about what changes that will make in enforcement trends, particularly for asset managers. Let's hear your view on that.
Sure. Thank you, Dorothy. You're exactly right. With the change in the administration, I think everyone here in the U.S. is expecting much more aggressive enforcement of the U.S. securities laws by both the SEC and the Department of Justice. President Biden has named Gary Gensler as the new chair of the SEC. However, he has not yet been confirmed, but there's been a lot of press articles that have been written about, you know, that he's an aggressive enforcer. He was aggressive while he was at the CFTC. So that's what I think everybody here in the US is waiting to see what this aggressive enforcement looks like.
Can I just ask that very question, Anthony?
Sure.
Unfair, because you've just said everybody's waiting to see. But you know, one of the complaints we hear quite often in the UK is that all the tools are there, but it's the appetite for using them that in some circumstances are said to be lacking. When you say everybody's anticipating aggressive enforcement, what sort of things could that be?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think it can reveal itself in a variety of ways. I think one, you could just have an increase in the number of investigations that are opened, right? Two, increase in the number of enforcement actions that are pursued. And then three, of course, more severe sanctions for those enforcement actions that are actually brought. And I think that even with the acting chair that's in place now, there's been sort of two statements that have come out of the SEC that I think signal the type of aggressive enforcement that we're going to see. I think first, the acting chair put out a release basically saying that they're going to reduce a level or a layer of review for issuing a formal order in the United States to subpoena documents. So prior to this statement, basically, the enforcement directors had to approve issuing a formal order, which allows the staff to subpoena documents. The acting chair has sort of changed that policy to sort of give that authority to a lower level of management, which means that formal orders can be issued more quickly. The staff has perhaps a little more discretion, but if anything, I think it's symbolic. I think it's a symbol. It's a statement that we are going to be more aggressive. And then a separate statement that was made by the acting chair concerns collateral consequences. In the United States, when you're charged with certain violations or for certain conduct, there can be collateral consequences that follow on from that. And you can apply for a waiver so that those collateral consequences will not apply. And so based on the statement that came out recently, I think there's a question, one, will waivers be granted for these collateral consequences? And you know, the statement already came out that you basically can't tie the waiver to a settlement agreement. So now parties are going to have to deal with entering into a settlement with the SEC without having the certainty that those that they're going to get a waiver for those collateral consequences. In addition, there's been a new statute in the United States that basically allows the SEC to disgorgement basically 10 years back in time for certain violations that involve scienter or sort of a heightened mental state, heightened conduct. And so I would expect, and we're already seeing that, where the staff is using this new statutory authority to go back 10 years to try to get money. I think you'll see, you know, a push for more bars and suspensions against individuals. In the past, if maybe there's a 1 or 2 year bar, will the staff now seek 5 year permanent bars against individuals? And I think you're going to see continued and increased focus on individual liability. So if the SEC is pursuing charges against an entity, they're going to look deep into that entity to see which individuals were involved. And they're going to seek to hold individuals accountable and likely be more willing to litigate. And so I think they're going to be working on their cases with a mindset so that they're trial ready to show the aggressive enforcement that they intend to pursue by going after individuals.
And with that observation, Anthony, which seems to have some commonality with what we've been hearing about and Matt's observations about the SMR, you know, if one were to be advising individuals responsible for running an asset manager, what might they need to do differently this year in particular, taking into account not just the change in administration, but as we've mentioned before, the different working circumstances? What's the best protection you can give yourself as somebody with executive responsibility?
Well, I mean, I think that the question for asset managers, I think there is going to be increased focus on asset managers generally. In the prior administration, there was a significant focus on retail accounts, retail clients, advisors to retail accounts. And, you know, there's been statements that the number of cases against private fund asset managers has sort of decreased over a number of years. And so I think just as to the asset manager population, you're going to see an increased focus. I think some of the areas that asset managers and executives need to be incredibly mindful of are conflicts of interest. That is a perennial area of focus for the SEC, looking at conflicts between the advisor and the fund, as well as conflicts that exist across the funds. And one of the key areas where the SEC brings cases dealing with conflicts is fees and expenses. So being mindful of how your fees and expenses are allocated, again, between the advisor and the fund and across funds. Most of these cases are brought either for not adequately disclosing the fee itself or not adequately disclosing how that fee is allocated. And so those are areas that you want to be mindful of. Valuation issues, another core area of asset management enforcement at the SEC. Many of those cases deal with valuing assets contrary to your disclosures or contrary to your policies and procedures. There have been cases where the SEC has charged advisors and asset managers for getting sham quotes or friendly broker marks from brokers. Trade allocation, this is another area that the staff will focus on, how you're allocating those profitable trades. They look at whether or not you're allocating to proprietary accounts where perhaps insiders of the advisor have their own money invested, whether you're allocating to accounts where friends and family are involved, and of course, allocating to those accounts that have higher performance fees. And again, the easier cases for the staff to bring in this area are when you're allocating just contrary to your disclosures or policies and procedures. Risk disclosures. There's been a few cases in the past dealing with disclosures surrounding risk. I would expect that to get continued attention. those cases focus on, again, just not disclosing the risk or stating that you have tools in place to manage the risk, but in fact, you're not using those tools or those tools do not actually exist. Preferential redemptions. If liquidity dries up and the market starts to go down, I think this is an area where the staff will focus on to see if you're letting insiders out of funds or friends and family out of funds that run contrary to your disclosed redemption procedures and policies. And then general cases where the fund is investing contrary to its disclosures. And I think in the US, where we might see a lot of attention for asset managers in this area, relates to ESG. I know it's familiar to all of you, but under the Biden administration and here in the US, ESG is getting a lot more attention and a lot more focus. And I believe that the SEC is anxious and eager to bring a case in this space. And if I had to guess, it would be a case where, you know, if the asset manager discloses an ESG strategy, it's not running the strategy consistent with the disclosures, or it's not using or getting the data that it says it's going to rely on and running the strategy. And then finally, policies and procedures. I know Matt talked a little bit about this, but here in the US, if perhaps the staff can't bring the substantive fraud charge for some of the conduct that we've discussed or I've mentioned, they might focus on the policies and procedures and bring a case stating that the policies and procedures weren't reasonably designed to address that conduct. That's happened in the past. And I think that we might see that continue to happen going forward.
Yeah, so I think we've maybe given the nightmares to all our listeners. I mean, first of all, that's a very comprehensive list. Secondly, the overlaps between what we've heard from the view from London and from Maria in Hong Kong is the similarity. I was actually going to mention ESG considerations in closing, because I agree with you, and I know my colleagues do, that that's a whole big area waiting to throw up potential enforcement activity. Inevitably, when you hear us speak, it's concentrating on the bad things that can happen. But I think what I've certainly taken away from hearing my partner speak today are some of the quick fixes, the more simple things that can be done in order to address or at best create your best protection against possible enforcement activity in future, and having a look at those activities now and again, give you some protection. Don't just sit there with stale policies, stale guidelines. Keep them refreshed, and keep them refreshed in the context of some of the developments we've been hearing about today. Most years, things are in a state of flux, but I think 2021 is really exceptional because of everything that's happened in the last year. And so to an extent, we're all looking out into a brave new world. But I hope you found the conversation we've had today useful, and we're all here to help you as things move forward. Thanks very much on behalf of DECA.